Okay, you may start, Alain.
Okay, two periodic meromorphic functions sharing a few small functions, I am, ignoring multiplicity. It's a joint work by C.C. Young and myself. Let K be an algebraically closed field of characteristic zero, complete for an ultrametric absolute value. We denote by D the open disk of center zero and radius R, and by E the complemental of that disk. We denote by A of K the algebra of entire functions in K, by A of D the algebra of power series converging in D, and next we denote by A of E the K algebra of Lorentz series converging in E. Next, we denote by M of K, or respectively M of D, the field of fraction of A of K, or respectively the field of fraction of A of D. And we will denote by AB of D, the K algebra of bounded analytic functions in D, and by MB of D, its field of fraction. We also denote by AU of D, the K algebra of unbounded analytic functions in D, and by MU of D, the set of meromorphic functions in D that are not a quotient of two bounded analytic functions in D. Finally, we denote by M of E the field of fractions of A of E, and we call these function in A, in E, the functions out of a whole. We have to introduce the counting functions of zeros and poles of F, counting or not multiplicity, which is essential for our study. Definition. Let F be a meromorphic function in some disk. We denote by omega of F the multiplicity order of zero if zero is a zero, or as a pole if zero is a pole, and else we put omega of S, M omega of F equals zero. Please turn the page. Okay. We denote by Z of R and F the counting function of zeros of F in the disk D of zero and R, counting multiplicity, and that is defined in the following way. Let AN be the sequence, finite sequence of zeros in that disk, and between 1 to sigma of R, and with absolute value of An inferior of absolute value of An plus 1, F absolute inferior equal to R, their respective orders being Sn. And then we define the counting functions of zeros, counting multiplicities as Z of R and F equal omega of F log of R plus sigma from N equal 1 to sigma of R of the Sn times log of R minus log of absolute value of An. So this is the counting function of zeros in D, counting multiplicity, or going to infinite if we are in K, or going to from zero to R if we are in the disk. And next, in order to define the counting functions of of F ignoring multiplicity, then we put omega bar of F equals zero if F has no zero at O, and omega bar of F equals one else. And we denote by Z bar of R and F the counting function of zeros of F multiplicity in the following way. Z bar of F equals omega bar of F log of R plus sigma from n equal 1 to sigma of R of the log of R minus log of absolute value of an. So the difference is that there is no Sn in that formula. Z bar is the counting function of zeros of F ignoring multiplicity. In the same way, considering the sequence of poles, then we define, we make the same definition with the poles, n of R and F equal omega of F log of R plus sigma from n equal 1 to tau of R. Tau is the number of distinct poles in the disk of center 0 and diameter R, the sigma of the Tn log of R minus log of Bn, absolute value of Bn, where Tn is the multiplicity order of the poles. And so it is the counting function of the poles, counting multiplicity. And finally, now we are going to define similar expressions for functions out of a whole in that way. I denote, let us recall that these functions are defined for absolute value of x superior or equal to capital R. And so I denote by z index R, capital R of small r and f equal sigma from n equal 1 to sigma of R of the same formula, Sn log of R minus log of An plus 1, log of absolute value of An, excuse me. And similarly, we denote by Z bar of capital R of R and F the same formula without the Sn. And we have the same formula for the poles with nr, n capital R of small r and f, and n bar of R of small r and f without multiplicity. So we are now going to the next page. Thanks. We can now define the characteristic function of f in these various cases. In general, we put T of R and F equal maximum of Z of R and F and N of R and F. And the formula is exactly good for functions in the full case, in the full field, excuse me, and or in the disk. And out of the disk, out of the hole, then we put T and index R of small r and f equal maximum of ZR and NR. Consider now a function out of the disk, out of the hole. By definition, the restriction of f to an annulus absolute value of x between r and s is an analytic element in the cluster meeting, and consequently it has finally zeros in that analysis. So we have proposition one. Let f be a meromorphic function in E if f has infinitely many zeros in E, or respectively infinitely many poles. The set of zero of a set of poles is a sequence whose absolute values go to infinite. And if is analytic in E and has no zero and no pole in E, then it is a Lorentz series of the form sigma of the an x to the n with for some q absolute value of aq r to the q strictly superior to an r to the n for n different from q, and for every small r superior or equal to capital R. And then there exists a unique integer q such that x to the minus q times f of x has a limit b different from zero in k. Then definition, taking such a function, the integer q is called the Motzkin index, and f, if the limit of x minus q f of x is equal to 1, if b is equal to 1, then f is then called Motzkin factor. So we can state proposition 1, 2, let f be a meromorphic function in E, then f has a unique factorization in the following way: f s times f zero, where f s is a Motzkin factor and f zero is an element in E that has continuation, an analytic continuation to an analytic element in the disk D, that an analytic element that has no zero in D. This is a result due to Elkhian and Motzkin in the 60s, 70s. Notation, we will denote by AC of E the set of function in E having infinitely many zeros in E, and similarly we denote by MC of E the set of function on E which have infinitely many zeros or infinitely many poles, at least one or the other. Then we can define counting functions for zeros and poles as we did for function in K and in D. Remark, if we change the origin, the functions z and t are not changed up to an additive constant. We can go to the next page. Thank you very much. General results, then these functions t, z, and so on satisfies what we can call the first main theorem for meromorphic functions in a periodic field. Taking f meromorphic in K or in D, then we have t, which is called the characteristic function. T of R and f plus b is Rolle equal to t of R and f up to a constant. T of f and t of r and f plus g is upper bounded by t of r and f plus t of r and g up to a constant. T of r and fg is upper bounded by T of R and F plus T of R and G, and T of R and 1 over F is equal to T of R and F. Now, suppose that F and G are analytic in K or in the disk, then we have T of R and F equal Z of R and F, of course, T of R and G equal Z of R and G, and T of R and F plus G is upper bounded now by the maximum of T and R and F and T of R and G. You see the obtuse constant. You see the progress, which will be very important in the last theorems. Similarly, we have the inequalities of the same kind concerning a function out of a hole. So please let's go to page 5. Okay, the Nevelinia theory is well known in C, and it was constructed by Abdelbaki Boutaba in K first. We had made it in the disk first, and finally we could make it out of a hole. Here is the second main theorem, which is really the essential result to work next. Let A1 and so on, AQ be the zeros, be values in K with Q equal superior or equal to 2. And let f be a meromorphic function either in K or in the disk, then we have Q minus 1 T of R and F upper bounded by the sigma from 1 to Q of the Z bar of R and F minus AG plus N bar of R and F minus log of R, this is very important, plus up to a constant plus O of 1. In the disk, of course, we have to restrict R to the interval 0, capital R. So the term minus log of R has no importance, no significance. No importance in the disk. And now let us go to the function out of a hole with the same hypothesis. Then we have Q minus 1 T index R of R and F is upper bounded by sigma of the G equal 1 to Q of the Z bar index R of R and F minus AG plus O of log of R, an expression bounded by some constant times log of R. We cannot do better for functions out of a hole. And now we are going to define small functions, which is the main topic here. Given a meromorphic function in K or in D or in E, we denote by MF of K, MF of D or MF of E, the set of functions H, in MK or M of D or M of E, such that the characteristic function T of R and H is a small o of T of R and F. Recall T of R and H is a small o of T of R and F when R tends to plus infinite when r tends to capital R in the disk. That means that the T of R and H over T of R and F tends to zero. And we denote by AF of K, respectively AF of D, in a moment, and AF of E, the set of the meromorphic function, the small function in each case. These functions are called, excuse me, the small functions. And the elements of MF of K or MF of D or MF of E are called the meromorphic functions or small functions in brief, and similarly for the analytic functions. We have a first theorem. Theorem 3.1, let A be a value in K and let R be positive. A index F of K is a K subalgebra of of A of K, of course. A F of D is a subalgebra of A of D. A F of E is a subalgebra of MF of K of A of E, excuse me, and similarly, MF of K is a subfield of M of K, MF of D is a subfield of M of D, and MF of E is a subfield of M of E. Moreover, AB of D is a subalgebra of AF of D. The bounded functions are, of course, are trivially small. Please, page 6. Thank you. Theorem 3.2. We have obvious relations concerning small functions. If I take a small function, really f in k or in d or in e, if I had a small function, if I take a meromorphic function, if I had a small function, then the characteristic function of the sum is really the same, and the characteristic function of the product is the same as this of f, and similarly for the quotient. So we will use these properties, and now we can state the Nivandina theorem on three small functions, which is well known concerning complex meromorphic functions, and the same exists for ultrametric functions. This is the following. Let f be a meromorphic function in k or in d or in e, and let omega 1, omega 2, omega 3 be three small functions relatively to f, then be pairwise distinct, then T of R and F is upper bounded by the sum from G equal 1 to 3 of the Z bar of R and F minus omega G plus something, a small function. And similar, we have the similar relation, of course, in D or in E. This is the end of the theorem. And now we can obtain another form of theorem 3.3. This is theorem 3.4. in according to the same hypothesis, but with only two small functions, omega 1, omega 2, then we have T of R and F is upper bounded by Z of R and F minus omega 1 plus Z bar of R and F minus omega 2 plus N bar of R and F plus a small function. Finally, we can obtain corollary 3-4 A taking an analytic function F, analytic in K or in D or in capital E, and taking two small functions relatively to F, then we have T of R and F inferior or equal to Z bar of R and F minus omega 1 plus Z bar of R and F minus omega 2 plus small functions. Of course, the N bar of R and F now has disappeared since F is analytic, so there is no pole. And finally, corollary 3-4 B, taking again an analytic function in one of these sets and a small function relatively to F, then T of R and F is upper bounded by Z bar of R and F plus Z bar of R minus omega plus a small function, because omega 1 can be 0, of course. So we are going to page 7. And now we are finding some new properties of small functions. First, let H and W be bounded functions in the disk, and let M, N be integers, so such that the minimum is of M and N of M and N is at least 2, and the maximum is at least 3. Then the functional equation G of X to the N equal H of X times F of X to the M plus a small function omega. The small function omega has no solution among the unbounded analytic functions. The solution that I would look for should be F and G. So there is no solution. And now we are going to the final result. I take again a function, meromorphic function on K, on D, on E, and so on. Three small functions, omega 1, omega 2, omega 2, omega 3. Then we have, Q small functions. Then we can show that Q times T of R and F is upper bounded by 3 sigma from G equal 1 to Q of the Z bar of R and F minus omega G plus small functions. The formula apply in K, in D, and in E. Moreover, if F has finitely many poles in K or in D or in E, which of course applies to analytic functions, then we can replace in the inequalities, we can replace 3 by 2, Q of T Q T of R and F is upper bounded by 2 sigma from G equal 1 to Q of the Z bar of R and F minus omega G plus a small function. And now two function, for instance, two meromorphic function, F and G, in K or in D or in E, will be said to share a small function omega, ignoring multiplicity if when F of X equal omega of X implies G of X equal omega of X, and G of X equal omega of X implies also F of X equal omega of X. So we can now state our main theorems. First theorem 4.3, let FG be two meromorphic functions in K or in D, or so when I take functions in D, I must take unbounded functions in D, mu of D, and I can take functions, meromorphic function FG in MC of E, which means that the functions have infinitely zero or infinitely many poles, at least one of the two property, and let them be distinct and share Q distinct small functions, ignoring multiplicity omega G. Then small function comparatively to F and to G. Then the sum from G from J equal 1 to Q of the Z bar of R minus omega J is upper bounded by Z bar of R and F minus G, plus a small function of F and a small function of G, comparatively to G. This theorem let us prove theorem 4.4 and corollary 4.4a. Here is theorem 4.4. Let FG be meromorphic functions, same hypothesis as in the previous theorem, and suppose that they share 7 distinct small functions other than the constant infinite, ignoring multiplicity. Then F and G are equal. I have suppose that they share 7 small functions. Then they are F and G are equal. Moreover, if F and G have finitely many poles and share only 3 distinct small functions other than the constant infinite, ignoring multiplicity, then F equal G. We can conclude with only three small functions. In particular, if we deal with analytic functions, of course, it is sufficient to share 3 small functions. And for conclusion, just a remark that in complex functions, Yamanoy proved a wonderful theorem in 2000. This is a theorem, an Evan-Lina theorem, not on 3 small functions, but on n small functions for every n. We do not have such a theorem for periodic analysis. It seems very, very hard to prove it. But instead of a theorem 4-4 with complex functions, we could prove that if they share five distinct small functions instead of seven, the conclusion is obtained. But when we now consider analytic functions, then it is necessary to have four, to share four analytic small functions. And you see that for analytic functions or functions having finitely many poles, then we can conclude in ultrametric analysis with only three small functions that are shared by F and G. I thank you very much. Thank you very much, Cordon.
Thank you, Alain. I think you did very well with time, and that should leave us some time for questions when the other participants join.
I don't know the time I have spent. Maybe
I think you did well. So we will meet again with the other participants.